I'm happy to be here tonight to represent Cal State Northridge as well as the Michael D. Eisner College of Education, where I am the interim dean. So my job is to welcome you to our university and encourage you to continue to seek out and attend our amazing community events, such as this one. Our university is diverse, and I'm proud to say that the services and events that we offer for our students, faculty, and our local community are equally diverse. Did you know, for example, that our College of Education hosts two literacy centers, an assessment library, a Mitchell Family Counseling Clinic, the Family Focus Empowerment Center, which is designed to help families of children with special needs? And did you know that we have university faculty working in schools to support literacy, STEM, deaf education, computer-assisted sciences, inclusive education, and much, much more, because we're just wonderful. The Center for Teaching and Learning within the College of Education is one of the many entities we have on campus who provide resources, activities, events, and programs for our university and the surrounding community, such as this one they are providing for us tonight. I'm proud to be a member of such a collaborative and inclusive environment, and equally pleased to be here for this event. I've heard excellent things about our speaker tonight, and boy, she is a dynamo, and I think you're going to really enjoy hearing her. So I look forward to learning more from Dr. Novac about how we can structure our classes at the pre-K through 12 and higher education levels so that more of our students can access information, show what they know, and truly be successful in strengths-based, universally designed environment. So without further ado, unless we're not ready, but are we ready? Because I don't know, I can perform, but I don't think you want to see it. I'd like to welcome our Executive Director and Eisner Endowed Chair for the Center for Teaching and Learning, Dr. Wendy Morawski.
How many of you have been to an Education on the Edge event before? Yes. Excellent. Well, welcome to those of you who have not. The Center for Teaching and Learning is the professional development and research hub of the College of Education. And so my job is to tell you a little bit about what we do. Events like these, the Education on the Edge speaker series, we put on a couple times a year. We always bring in just dynamic speakers who have a topic of interest that we think is cutting edge, that we really want to bring to our community. And we also, of course, want to make sure they're speakers that you would want to hear. So these are the big names that maybe you wouldn't have a chance to see otherwise. And we've managed to secure them and bring them in and then not give them the technology they need. That's what we do, because we're good like that. We also do a whole lot of other things. So every other year, we put on the What Really Works in Education conference. And we would love you to join us. We do it every other year. We did it last year, so we'll be doing it again. Come on. Next year. See, you got to make sure you're with us. We have published 3 books. We have, the recent one was What Really Works with Exceptional Learners. We have What Really Works in Secondary Education and What Really Works in Elementary Education. At the end of this evening, we will be doing a raffle. Did everyone get the raffle tickets? Yes? If you didn't, you need to hustle out there, make sure you get a raffle ticket. We will be raffling off one of each of these books, in addition to quite a few of this little ditty here. You didn't know we were going to give away your books, did you? You thought people might buy them. But nope, we just give them away like they're candy. We have a bunch of Katie Novak's UDL Now, which is really a fantastic book, very, very practical. So those of you get a chance to win it in the raffle, awesome. If you don't win it in the raffle, it's not too late. We do have books in the back for you to purchase. And Katie, whether she knows it or not, will be staying and doing a book signing. So you thought you were going to fly in from Massachusetts and head back out? No, girl, we got you for a while. Anyway, we also do, so we do the What Really Works conference every other year. Those of you who might have seen this when you came in, we put out the National T-Care newsletter. This is now a peer-reviewed national publication, and we have great articles for teachers, for counselors, for administrators. We always have a page that is near and dear to our dean's heart on self-care, because that is so important. So we have the Caring Connection and a self-care corner. We have tips from Teachers of the Year, etc. So make sure you're on our mailing list, and the mailing list, you can just text us right now, email us right now, ctl@csun.edu. ctl@csun.edu. Just email us and say, I'd like to be on the mailing list. You'll find out about all the next Education on the Edge events. We already know who's coming next time, but we're not going to tell you right now. But we're really excited. You'll find out about you'll get our newsletter. We don't spam, we don't sell your email, any of that kind of fun stuff. So you'll just hear about our events and get some of our publications. So we are always thrilled to host these Education on the Edge events, because we feel like it's a service to the community. And we go into schools, we do speaking engagements at schools, we have contracts with schools. So if you hear about topics that you want to know more information and you want the College of Education to support your school or help you out in some way, please do contact us at the Center for Teaching and Learning. We also always ask someone in our community who we think has some kind of a connection to our speaker to do the introduction for our speaker. And before I introduce that person, I will tell you that I've had the delightful experience to actually co-present with Katie Novak in Ohio. And we had such a great time. It was when I knew immediately she had to be our Education on the Edge speaker, because she had exactly the combination of amazing content, practical experience, and sense of humor that we need to have for our speakers. So I'm really glad you're here, Katie. And now I'd like to introduce, did you guys know that Cal State Northridge has a Universal Design Center on campus? Raise your hand if you knew that. Oh, only a few of you. Well, we do. And the program manager for the Universal Design Campus right here on Universal Design Center right here on campus is Kate Sharon, and Kate is going to do the introduction for Dr. Katie Novak. So please welcome Kate Sharon.
So thank you. My name is Kate Sharon. I am the program manager for the Universal, there's the microphone, for the Universal Design Center here on campus. However, I will be completely honest with you. My background is in technology, but not fixing projectors. My background is more in these, and I can talk to you all day about universal design and accessibility features of mobile phones, for example, but I've been with the Universal Design Center for about a year and a half, and I am learning rapidly about universal design for learning. So the CSU system has what we call the Accessible Technology Initiative. We are trying to make all of the instructional materials, all the websites, everything that we put in our students' hands, we're trying to make them accessible. And so I have a technology background, but I'm trying to understand better universal design for learning, trying to understand our faculty and the technologies that they use. So opportunities like this one, the resources that CSUN makes available to us, having Dr. Novak here tonight is just invaluable to me. One of the resources that my center uses is CAST. CAST is one of the places that we go to for training. Dr. Novak has published 4 books through CAST. The 4th one is coming out now. So Dr. Novak is a former teacher and the current assistant superintendent of schools with the Groton-Dunstable Regional School District in Massachusetts. And I jumped between my topics, so I apologize. But again, as I've mentioned, It is just wonderful to have the opportunity to have you here in person, to be able to hear you in person, and have this resource available both to me as a member of the CSUN community and to the wider campus community.
Okay. Hello, everybody. Thanks for coming tonight. We are just going to dive right in. If you want to know more about me, you're welcome to Google me. That's pretty much what I do when I go to PD. It's like, who's this person? Just go straight to the source in the internet. But I want to talk to you tonight about universal design for learning and how we have to transform teaching and learning at all levels if we really want students to access our instruction, be engaged, and then become really successful in the future. And so we're going to start just by diving straight in and talking about the goals and objectives for this short talk. Now, over what you'll see there is called the golden circle. Simon Sinek, who is a leadership consultant, talks about this concept of a golden circle and says that so often we talk about what we do and we talk about how we do it, and very rarely do we talk about why we do what we do. And so if you think about why you're here, you'll say, oh, I'm here because I teach history, because I'm a special educator, because I'm a principal. That's what you do. And then some of us might even get into the nitty-gritty of, well, how do we do it? And there's so many educational frameworks that you can use. So you could say, oh, I use understanding by design. I'm really committed to co-teaching. I use universal design for learning or differentiated instruction. And that's how we do what we do. But what's really important about tonight is why do we do what we do? And it's easy to forget in education why we're here. Because things get really, really cloudy and convoluted. We are not here because we want test scores to go up. Okay, that is a result of really great teaching. We are not here because it's so important for students to know the definition of a certain word in our classes. Okay, we're here for another much bigger reason. And when we remember that reason, it's very clear how we have to move from why we're doing it to find a way that will allow us to get to where we want to go, and then we can look at our content. So I want you to just take a minute and think about why you do what you do. Because it's not so kids get good grades on tests. I don't think very many of us care. We didn't go into teaching because we're like, man, I want to see a kid get a 95 on an exam. Okay, so why do we do it? Turn to somebody, or you can tweet. Is there a hashtag for this event?
Hashtag EdOnEdgeNovac.
Sounds fabulous. So you're going to like tweet it up, or you're going to talk about it. Just 30 seconds. Why do you do what you do? Why were you inspired to be a teacher or an administrator or a professor? Ready, go. Okay. So we're going to get loud for a second here, and I'm just going to say, I want you to think of why you do what you do, and I want you to boil it down to one word. Okay? That's your ultimate challenge. And then when I say go, you're going to yell out your word. Ready? One, two, three. Okay, that's not loud enough. One, two, three. Okay, I didn't hear tests from anyone. Okay, I don't think I heard essay. Okay, I didn't hear Carnegie rule. Okay, so why do we do what we do? And I can guarantee you, the more you learn about UDL, the more you'll see, yes, this is the framework that allows me to teach the way I want to teach so I get to my why. And so let's talk a little bit about UDL and how UDL is about voice and choice. So how do we create opportunities for all students to be able to express what they know in ways that they can express it? How do we get their voice? And then how do we give them choice? So I am from New England. I live outside of Boston. And back in Boston, an ice cream truck is like a big deal. Okay, I don't know if we do ice cream trucks on the West Coast, but they're huge. So I have four little ones. And when we go to the beach in the summer, they could literally be 5 miles out to sea. And then they hear the ice cream truck, and suddenly they're all there. You know, it's like a moth to a flame. So I'm gonna play you a little song here so you can experience what it's like to be a child who hears the ice cream truck, okay? Ready? Get in the way, you're in. Wow, that's very loud, okay. So there's some lovely ice cream truck music playing, and you hear this song, and it's like a beacon of hope, of like, I am going to get a cold frozen treat, and it's gonna be amazing. Now, here is the difference between options and choices, which I think we really need to capture as educators and leaders. So this ice cream truck here, you can't see it, but right about here on the ice cream truck, okay, there's something on the side. Does anyone know what goes on the side of that ice cream truck? The menu, your different options. Perfect. Okay, so we're familiar. So you're little, and I want you to think about, what are you going to order from this ice cream truck? So take your 7-year-old self to a beach that's 110 degrees, and I want you to put in your order. So tell someone next to you, what are you ordering from that ice cream truck? Ready, go. What are you getting, Wendy? Woohoo! What are you going to get from the ice cream truck? Oh. A what? Oh, I love a good fudgicle. Okay. So, this is what UDL is all about. Voice and choice. So first of all, I'm going to ask you what you want, and you're going to use your voice, okay? Ready? What are you going to order? Fantastic. So we have all of these options, and I'm giving you a choice. Now, here is what we often do in school. You all know what you actually want, okay? But I'm not going to ask you what you want, because you know what? I don't have time for that. So instead, I'm going to make my decision of what you're going to get. Okay, so you know options exist as a kid. And students know options exist. They know you can learn from books. They know you can learn from a lecture, you can learn from videos. There's a lots of different ways that you can learn. And they also know there's options for sharing what they know in traditional multiple choice tests, on essays, in more authentic projects. So those options are there on this metaphorical side of your school. And then students walk in and we say, today we're serving chocolate peanut butter ice cream. That's what I'm serving to you. But worry not, because this is the best chocolate peanut butter ice cream you have ever had in your life. And I spent a lot of time prepping it, and everybody who's ever had it loves it, and that's what we're having. Okay? So you come up, you're all excited, you're like, oh, I'm totally into the fudgicle. I am like 100% into the creamsicle. And I'm like, oh, that's nice, but that's not what we're doing. We're having chocolate peanut butter ice cream. Now, how many of you are totally cool with that? You're gonna eat my chocolate peanut butter ice cream. My gosh, that's it? This is devastating. Okay, I don't think you understand that I shelled the peanuts myself. Okay, so I'm now feeling like, what on earth is going on? So a lot of you want to eat my ice cream, but like some of you don't, and that's like sad. Now, if you could just tell me, why don't you want to eat my ice cream? Could someone tell me, please? Oh, you have an allergy. Picky eater. Okay? Okay. So one of the reasons why some students cannot access is because there's a restriction. There's some sort of accessibility issue. Okay? We cannot say that you have to get around that. You just have to eat nuts. Okay? There's this concept of some students can't access certain information, so we have to give them a different option and a different choice. But there's some of you here who could access that chocolate peanut butter ice cream. There's no dietary restriction. There's no dietary needs. Why won't you eat it? You're sick of it. Okay, what else? You want something else. When our students are struggling, when they're bored, when they're like on the very low end of compliance, it's because they know other options exist and they know what they are, but we don't ask them. We don't tell them, you know, say, what, can you think of another way to get to this standard? And so we don't optimize their voice and we don't optimize their choice. Now I work with teachers, you know, I'm a 0.8 assistant superintendent of schools, and I'll have teachers who are like, Novac, you're gonna be so proud of me. I used to give a final exam and now everyone's doing a podcast. That is literally no more universally designed than the original test. Because there's still no choice. And then some people say, oh no, I give a lot of choices because like one day I'll show a video and then the next day I'll lecture. Okay, so that's fantastic. Today's chocolate peanut butter ice cream. Tomorrow's cashews and nuts. Tomorrow's pralines and cream. I'm giving a ton of choices. So it's really interesting. I want you to like really grapple with how much choice do your students get? Whether it's pre-K, whether you're a professor, whether you're an educator and you're teaching through professional development, how much choice is there? So moving forward, I want to use another analogy, and this is a little dinner party analogy here. And what I want you to think about for a moment is it is 1970, okay? And we are like loving life, and this looks like my grandmother's kitchen, and we're here. Now, my friends Marvin and Tammy are gonna sing a little ditty, and when they're done with their song, you're gonna be done with your research and or discussion. So here's the magic. You own a catering company in 1970, and I want a casserole. It must fit in a dish. So don't get all fancy on me and do fondue. I want it in a dish. It needs to be a one-pan wonder, and you're welcome to use your devices. So feel free to research what was a really good casserole in 1970. Now, you only can do things that were like super cool in 1970, but I want you to create one dish and you can pour your heart into it, okay? And then we're gonna go through the analogy of what happens when we lesson plan with one assessment in mind. So it must fit in a dish. When Marvin and Tammy are done, you're gonna be done talking and researching. Here we go. Just a little music.
Listen, baby.
Okay, so we have this amazing casserole, and often when we plan lessons, like how we're going to teach, or assessments, which is how are we going to know that students understood something, we think about a casserole. It's kind of like a one-size-fits-all, everybody's going to get the same thing. You know, I'm going to hand out this test to everybody, I'm going to hand out this blue book to everybody, whatever it happens to be, everyone's going to write an essay. And then this is what happens, okay? So can somebody just tell me what's your one dish wonder? Ooh, tuna noodle casserole. Very high-end 70s fare. Okay, I believe it's a can of tuna, a can of cream of mushroom soup, a can of fried onions. If you really had the money, you could put American cheese on top. And then there was some noodles. But I mean, let's not go crazy here. And then what happens is this. People show up to your party. And you start going, uh-oh, this doesn't work for everyone. And if you are currently a teacher or professional development provider, you'll realize that when you plan one thing, there's always going to be some students who either cannot access it or they don't want to do it. They're not going to put in a lot of effort. It's like, I'll just take like the easiest route to get out of this because I don't personally care. I don't want to eat that. And so we look at these people and what we realize is we have to start making these reactive accommodations. And that's number one, more work. And number two, takes away the original intent of the meal. So Lucy can't have that. So you know what I'll do? I'll just rinse off the noodles. You know, put them through a colander real quick, some cold water, it'll be fine. So now we're frustrated because it's like Lucy's not even really eating a wholesome meal. And now we start worrying about what are we going to give to Lucy? What are we going to give to Nathaniel? What are we going to get to Greg? And then you start feeling so frustrated because you're like, now I'm making six meals. But there's a better way to do that. When we think about options and choice, it's actually a lot easier for students to make their own plate without us having to do all the work. And there's huge benefits to that. And so that's what we're going to talk about, which is what is UDL? It's to give students options and then allow them to make choices so we can get to a point where we're not worrying about all of these diners, but that we put out a buffet and they can go and make their own plates. So UDL is it's based on 30 years of research about what happens in the brain when students are learning. And there's three different networks of the brain that have to be lit up on an fMRI in order for students to learn. And those three parts of the brain are the affective network, which is this core center of the brain, the recognition network, and then the strategic network. And the way that this works for teaching and learning is this is the why. Why do I even need to know this? Then it's what do I need to know? And this is where teaching comes in. Like if you think of traditional teaching, like I'm gonna explain this to you, I'm gonna assign you a chapter, we're gonna do this activity as a class. That's so students build some kind of knowledge. They wanna recognize information. And then assessments, that's the strategic network. Is how do we know that you have learned it? So all three parts of this brain have to be lit up. And traditional education really looked just at this, of like, what am I going to teach them? And then how are they going to show me what they know? But the problem is now we know a lot more about engagement. It's like this magical word. And engagement is, why do I even need to know this? Why is it important or relevant or authentic to me? And if you can't do that, these are lights out. And so this whole concept here, I like to use the analogy of a heating system, is you're not getting your burner to turn on and blow out hot air if the thermostat isn't set. Are we setting our students' thermostats? Are we making it really clear why this is important to know? And then allowing them to learn it in a way that's best for them, and then express it back in a way that's best for them, while still maintaining the integrity of the standard. Okay, there are certain things that we want students to know and do. So right here, this is where UDL really sets itself apart from other types of frameworks. Because what it comes down to here is this engagement piece. So I want you to take a second and just think about what you currently believe engagement to be. And if you have a phone with a QR code reader, you can just put it up there and you can scan that really quickly and you can just type in what you think the definition of engagement is. And if you don't have a QR code reader, you can use that short URL and you can go there. So just take a moment and either talk to someone next to you and say, my understanding of engagement is, or you can type it in there really, really quick, and then I'm going to pull up the Padlet in 30 seconds and show you what our current understanding of engagement is. And then we're going to unpack it through the UDL lens. So take a moment, either go to this website on your phone, scan this with your QR code reader, or you can just talk about it with someone next to you. Okay, so they're starting to pop up and people are still typing. But what you can see here is these definitions of engagement are starting to pop up. So interest, interaction, interesting, interested, high interest, holding someone's attention, okay? And this is where a lot of people kind of land with, okay, I want my students to be engaged. I want them to be engaged. So we want them to be interested. We want them to be actively listening. Maybe we want them involved in hands-on activity. Maybe we want to gain their attention. We want them to forget to look out the window. So they're enthralled, they're paying attention, they're interested. And that is what most people think of engagement as. But really interestingly, the research on engagement, attention and interest are the smallest part of engagement. If you read the research on engagement and you talk about, you know, brain plasticity and neuroscience, what's really fascinating about this is that engagement, and don't worry about that you cannot read this because I'm going to just highlight a couple words. These are called the UDL guidelines, and you can look those up on your phone. But engagement is equal parts interest. So right here it says, how do you build engagement? It says providing multiple options for recruiting interest, and interest is about attention. But that's only 1/3 of the engagement equation. The other two pieces are, you have to be able to sustain effort and persistence, which means you have to be challenged out of your comfort zone. If you are not challenged, if it is not hard, you are not engaged by the definition of engagement. And also, it needs to be so hard that in order to keep going, you have to, number one, have motivation, and number two, know how to cope and self-regulate. So true engagement is so challenging that it makes you uncomfortable. And that is a very different view of why we are teaching. Because if we believe that our jobs are to make it easy for students, we are stealing the opportunity for them to be engaged. We are allowing them to be interested, but they are not engaged. And there's been a lot of studies about American students and their significant lack of engagement, in the true sense of the word. Now, are they interested? Absolutely. Might they be actively participating if it seems fun for them? Yes. But the definition of success, if you are engaged and you want to be successful, it means you kept going when everyone else quit. That's what success is. And so if we teach students when things get hard to say, I just can't do it anymore, it's too hard, you have to help me, how are they going to compete with students who are willing to work a lot harder? So again, UDL is about these three different networks of the brain, and these three principles of UDL align. So if you want to activate that effective network, it's really about teaching students how to be purposeful and motivated. And what it means to be purposeful and motivated is you're willing to overcome obstacles and barriers and challenge, and you know how to cope with that frustration. And then if we want them to be knowledgeable and resourceful, we have to activate this recognition network. The problem is we often give students all the resources they need, so they become knowledgeable but not resourceful. And then lastly, the whole purpose of assessment is so we can help them to become strategic and goal-directed. But how can they do that if we always tell them exactly what we expect? And so the goal of UDL is not acquisition of knowledge. It is acquisition of expert learning. And an expert learner is somebody who is resourceful, knowledgeable, strategic, goal-directed, purposeful, and motivated. And if we can give kids that, even if they don't get 95s on our test, even if they don't nail the essay, they're going to do okay. But here's the problem. Is what we see a lot of in American schools, and this is Rios's research, is that we don't see a lot of engagement. We see a lot of compliance. Compliance means they will pay high attention. They will forget to look out the window, and they will be really hands-on involved actively in their learning when they are sitting in front of you, because you are there to save them when it gets hard. And then what happens is because of this lack of commitment, and again, commitment is both the ability to sustain effort and persistence and the ability to cope. What do I do now? I don't get it. Okay? If you can't do this, then you are not engaged. And so if you look at these definitions here, okay, you'll know where in your life you're engaged Like, no matter what, you're gonna stick with it. And you'll also know in your life that you're not gonna do more than you have to do. And we have a lot of students in our universities, in our classrooms, that will not do more than they have to do. And that means they are compliant, they are not engaged, no matter how much they may be actively participating when we put on a show. So if we want to change this, we have to start thinking very differently about the types of opportunities that we give students to learn information and to give us back what they have learned. And what you'll realize is on the same spectrum that you see engagement, you'll also see retreatism and rebellion. And these are really ineffective coping strategies. I don't get it, so I'm gonna shut down. I'm gonna stop going to class. I don't get it, so I'm gonna act out. I'm gonna be funny. I'm gonna say I don't care. Okay, that is, I don't like the feeling I'm having. And so I am going to act out in another way. Now, what's really fascinating, this right here is my little love, Aylin. So I'm a mom of four. I have a 7-year-old son, twin 6-year-olds. One of them is a girl, that's her, and then a little 2-year-old. And this is my sweet Aylin. And this right here is a really great definition of an expert learner. She had a goal, get iPads out of very high cabinet, okay? Her strategy was, and I actually think it's pretty brilliant, create a very large base of dining room chairs, precariously balance a laundry basket upside down on said chairs, and then put a package of perler beads on top because apparently the laundry basket didn't get much higher. So when you think about expert learning, I want her to be motivated and purposeful. Okay, it's pretty clear. If you're motivated and purposeful, you can find your own resources to build knowledge, to get to your goal. She's like, oh, these dining room chairs and this laundry basket look good. I mean, the laundry basket isn't even the kitchen. She went out of her way to find that. Okay, that's called a strategy. That's called executive functioning. Okay, and then what she did is there was definitely some trial and error because I bet you she tried this first and then it fell. Okay, ultimately her goal was achieved. Now, this could be a disaster because she could fall off, but we would actually say that's great because she has learned from mistakes. And so we don't have a lot of students who do this. So there was a study done by James Stigler at University of Michigan, and he went into Japan, and then he went into the US, and he took a handful of students, there's like 30 students, and he gave first graders a math problem that could not be solved. And then he said, you can work on this together, see what you can do with it, go as long as you can before you hit the bell. And in the US, the average time a group took to hit the bell, as you can see, is 30 seconds. 30 seconds, tapped out. Well, we can't do it. In Japan, there wasn't a single group that ever hit the bell. He had to stop every group at an hour. So how do our first graders today compete with those kids in 20 years? Our kids give up after 30 seconds. And none of them, there was no exceptions, ever quit. We won't compete. And so what we are doing now is we are creating an education system that is so focused on this acquisition of knowledge right here that it's at the expense of teaching students how to be purposeful, motivated, resourceful, strategic, and goal-directed. And knowledge is not as important as it used to be, as much as that kills us as lovers of knowledge. Because students can look up almost anything on their phones in their real jobs. And so this content knowledge, it's a part of the equation. It's a sixth of the equation, but it's not 100% of the equation. And we have some classrooms that are still teaching in a way that the goal is knowledge. And now UDL says it's got to be bigger than this. We have to teach kids how to get gritty, how to have a growth mindset, how to learn from their own mistakes, that failure and risk-taking is okay, how to find their own resources, and how to tell the difference between resources that are really accurate and those that are not, and then how to set their own goals. Instead of us always saying, this is exactly what you have to do. And so you see, it's a very different way to view teaching and learning through the UDL lens when your goal, when your why, is we believe that this is important for all of our kids. And to do that, we have to teach in a different way. So They're not doing it yet. It's really easy to hear about that, and I work with, you know, pre-K and elementary teachers. You know, I work with middle and high school teachers. I teach graduate courses. When you think about this, it's really easy to say, if I just put out a bunch of options and said to kids, here's the standard, you tell me how you want to learn it, and you tell me how you're going to show me what you know, they can't do it. Well, they can't do it yet, because we have never even given them an opportunity to try to do it. And when you give someone an opportunity to try something, the first 10, 15, 20 times, they stink at it. So how many of you surf? Oh my gosh, there's two. Okay. We have two surfers. It is hard, right? So a lot of us go, I can't surf. That's not true. You can't surf yet. That's a growth mindset. You can't surf yet. Anyone can surf. But the two of you, if you talk the rest of us surfing and you're like, just jump on the board and try it, it will be a disaster. Okay? And many of us will say, see, I told you I can't surf. This isn't for me. That's what happens to a lot of students. The people who stay motivated enough to keep getting back on that board will become surfers, regardless of any ability or disability, because you can make adaptations if you're truly committed and purposeful and motivated. And Malcolm Gladwell, he wrote the book Outliers, and he basically said, what sets somebody apart? How do you create an outlier, someone who's the top 1% of their field? And he says, obviously, you know, there's some baseline intelligence. You're smart enough, okay? And you work hard enough. But it's not the hardest workers who are the most successful, and it's not the smartest people who are the most successful. It's actually those people who have the most opportunity to practice. The best surfers in the world are the people who spend 10 hours a day surfing. And the best teachers in the world are those people who spend their entire days and nights researching and getting professional development and joining Twitter chats and trying things and asking students, how did it go? And we don't get really good at things that are hard without a ton of practice and a ton of commitment. And that involves us as teachers being expert learners who are purposeful and motivated and who will deal with the discomfort of giving up control of your classroom and watching kids fail in order for them to succeed. So there's this temptation when you hear about we have to start giving students choices, because when you have choices presented to you, you have to self-reflect, you have to self-direct, and you have to create a strategy. And some of us go, oh, I already do that. Yeah, it's me. I do that already. Now, here's the thing. See that little lovey right there? This little lovey? He's not my child. He's a free stock photo. But he's super cute. So that little lovey right there is a runner, okay? And so I would say to him, hey, like, I'm running a marathon. I think I could really help you. No, I'm a runner already. I'm good. How often do we hear teachers say that? I do that already. Like, my head will explode the next time I hear someone say it. Oh, I do that already. No coaching for me. Okay, so if this little lovey right here says, I am a runner already, he's not going to turn out to be a great runner. Now, these girls here, this is a college cross-country team. They could also say, I run already, I'm good. And then this dude here, he won the Boston Marathon last year. He could also say, I'm already a runner. No tips for me. Don't tell me to change my sneakers or change my diet. I'm not trying anything new. The reason that this kid becomes this guy is because of expert learning. It's because this person is literally willing to get uncomfortable, to fall down and get back up, to work through injuries, to have somebody to push them further than they ever thought they could go. So your job as a teacher is not less important than in traditional education. It's actually more important. Because we have to push these kids, because the world is not going to make things easy for them, especially when they're competing against kids who naturally have been taught from birth not to give up. So we gotta push them. We gotta put them in situations where they're running and they're pulling weight and it's raining and it's going longer and farther. And they aren't going to like it. Because I can tell you, I'm running my first full marathon in a couple of weeks and I am not going to like it. Okay? But We do this because the goal is more important than the frustration and the injury and the pain. And we don't see kids who care that much about school where they won't give up no matter what. And that's on us. We have to create an environment where we give them choices and we say, no, you're gonna learn how to make great choices. You tell me how you're gonna show me that you know this history content, okay? You take this, these math problems, there's 20 of them, you solve 10 of them, and then you have to explain how you solve them, but I want you to do it down to elementary school kids. Do whatever you need to do. Manipulatives, videos, audio, but that's on you, and this is what you're gonna get. How many PowerPoint slides do I need in the presentation? I don't know. How many do you need to explain it to second graders? How do I get an A, though? Seriously? I'm grading you on whether or not the kids understand it. Well, what am I supposed to do? That's because you've never had to think totally out of the box. So where do you provide these choices? Okay, now you have to start somewhere. That marathon runner started as the 7-year-old runner. And every person ever who becomes a really great outlier in UDL practice starts where that 7-year-old started. It's, what's your first race? And here are your choices. You can either start with goals. So you can say, you know what, I want students to think about how they want to learn the information. So this is how you do it. Okay, everyone, here's the standard. Here's the outcome. Take 10, 15 minutes. Tell me how you want to learn this and how you're going to show me what you know. Just help me out here. I'm not saying we're going to do it 100%, but I want your ideas of like how you think you could learn this. Okay, you can change your methods, which means that we're still going to require the essay, we're still going to require the computation of math, we're still going to require the lab, but we might say, I want you to think about what you need, how are you going to get to this end point? Do you need to come to office hours? Do you need to come to the lab? Could you do it on your own? Could you do a virtual lab? Are we going to let them use different materials? Hey, you're still all going to solve this math problem, but you can choose to work together, you can choose to use manipulatives, you can choose to look at Khan Academy online, you can choose to use a math reference sheet, you can use your calculator, whatever it happens to be. Or you could start by changing up your assessments, meaning your instruction's still gonna look the same, okay? They might have the same materials, but in the end, you're gonna say, to show me that you really understand the concept of photosynthesis, for example, you can do an interactive multimedia presentation. You can create an online video or audio recording, but it needs to be edited and it needs to be held for 6 minutes because you don't want rambling. I've made that mistake. You can record a video and then someone hands in like a 75-minute I'm like, oh my gosh, no. Like, I do not want 75 minutes of you talking. So limit it. But these are your options of where you can start. And you don't know, like I can't tell you where to start because that's a really personal choice of what are you willing to let go of first as a teacher. For me, the hardest thing to let go of was the methods. Like, I'm super interesting, why would I not teach? And then when I got to the point after 3 years where I'm like, you can stay with me and I'm so fun, or you can watch the video, they're like, video, I'm like, what? But then they still really did awesome on the assessment. So I'm like, oh my gosh, they don't need me. But you know where they do need me? That feedback place. Because when they turn it in and it's not that great, that video can't tell them how to make it awesome. That video can't push them to the right resources. That video can't inspire them to go back and do more. So there's different ways for them to learn, okay? And there's different materials they can use. And ultimately, we can give them different assessments to get to the same outcome. But what that cannot be automated is our coaching, is our mastery-oriented feedback, is the fact that we proactively give them options to try, and then we're there to say, okay, so now you learned that that isn't going to work for you, so let me help you. So why do we do this? Okay, Jean Anion in 1980 coined the term hidden curriculum to say that the way that teachers treat students, even when they're using the same curriculum, helps students to try to conceptualize what is success. And when she went into working class schools, that's what she called them, so areas where there was significant poverty, the parents, if they were working, were often in minimum wage, low wage jobs. She found that the teachers were sending a hidden message that success was doing what I am telling you to do. Raise your hand, I will speak to you. It was very much about classroom management. There's only one way to write an essay. Okay, this is how you hand in your work. I'm taking off points if you don't have your name in the upper right-hand corner. Okay, it was very much your job is to be respectful to me and to follow rules. And these teachers loved their kids. She wasn't giving a negative evaluation to what they were doing. But she's like, it was very clear that success in those schools was you do what I tell you to do and you'll be good. What jobs are you really good at if all you ever know how to do is follow directions and not question authority? It's a pretty low ceiling on that. Now, she went into these elite schools. They were using the same curriculum. They might be reading the same exact book, using the same exact textbook. And these teachers were like, all right, like there's kids sitting on the back of the radiators. Some kids are on the floor, and this is 1980, so there wasn't like a lot of computers yet. But, some kids were in small groups. They're reading different books. Hey, miss, can we go outside today? Oh, well, I don't know. The weather's not great. Like, how about we make a plan? And she was like, oh my gosh, she's teaching them success is learning how to be respectful, but advocating for what you need, personalizing your journey, and making sure that you can get what you want out of life. And she basically said that this hidden work perpetuates the status quo. Because what we end up creating is we end up creating a world where certain kids just can't do certain things because we never give them opportunity to learn what we now call 21st century skills. And this is I really think a silly phrase, because like the Einsteins and the Graham Bells and the Edisons were always these things. So we call them 21st century skills. Some people call them transferable skills. What it comes down to is if you want to be really successful today, you have to learn how to be a really great communicator. And that's both expressive, like when I send emails, when I talk to you in person, and then, receptive. Do you understand the communication cues you're getting? Okay, you have to be self-directed. You have to be a creative, innovative problem solver. And you have to be, for the love of all that's good, it has never been more important to be a responsible, informed citizen. And if we want kids to be this, these are, again, the UDL guidelines. Don't worry too much about the weeds right now. But students will never really navigate what it means to communicate with different tasks and purpose and audiences when we always tell them exactly what their audience is going to be. Right now, you're going to present to second graders. You need to simplify vocabulary. You need to let them figure it out. Let them struggle. This idea of self-direction, if we don't provide options for you tell me how you're going to do this, how are they going to learn to set goals and persevere? Okay, and why is this more important now than it's ever been? Because again, 21st century skills, kind of a silly phrase. Well, this is why we call them 21st century skills. This is from the U.S. Department of Labor Statistics. And this came out after Donald Trump announced that we saved 1,000 jobs from going to Mexico. They were called the carrier jobs. And NPR put out an article that said carrier will keep 1,000 jobs, but Trump faces a much tougher problem. And the tougher problem is, in 10 years, those jobs are gone. Saving manufacturing jobs in this country is not going to help anyone in 20 years. Those jobs are gone. And that was what they're saying is, how do you create more innovation and more engagement in our students? Because we are not sending kids to manufacturing jobs. We are sending robots to manufacturing jobs that the kids who do have 21st century skills are inventing to replace the people who don't have those skills. And so what they're saying here is that there's four different buckets of jobs. And I do not like these terms, but this is the U.S. Department of Labor Statistics, so we're going to use them. Okay, they call them non-routine cognitive jobs. That's you. You're thinkers. Okay, you don't have someone in your room every day telling you what to do. And believe me, you do not want that. So as frustrating as it is, it's like, how am I going to do this? Believe me, you don't want me to tell you how to do it. Because you get to be creative and innovative and a problem solver, and people trust you with their children. There is no greater gift in the world than a parent who says, I will give my kid to you knowing you'd take a bullet for my kid. There is no better job in this entire universe. than being able to be a role model for kids and to teach them how to be successful in their world. But to do that, you have to be a creative problem solver. You have to be able to communicate to kids when they're hungry, when they're hurting, when they're sad, when they're happy, when they want to give up. That's us. Then there are these two middle jobs. We call these routine cognitive and non-cognitive. Okay, so like secretaries, manufacturing, and then this non-routine manual work. Now, if you think about these guys right here, okay, these architects, these men and women who are architects, who are educators, who are professors, who are thinkers, who are engineers, you know, whatever they are, they're getting so good at being self-directed creative problem solvers that their jobs are increasing at the expense of all of these jobs down here. Because why do you need a secretary if I have canned responses on my email and transcription software that is so exact that it's 99% correct, and I have automatic electronic filing? Okay, why do I need a manufacturing job when I have a robot? Why do I need a hotel maid when I have a vacuum that can go into a room and clean up? Why do I need a waiter when I have an iPad? Okay, there's a new restaurant chain called You Eat, which is actually, Eat You, which is, it's not staffed, totally electronic. Okay, 20% of men in this country, 20% make their living driving something. Pilots, taxi drivers, UPS, mail, long haul, 20%. In 20 years, we'll have self-driving vehicles. 20% of our jobs will be gone. And this is our problem. And if we don't come up with an educational framework that gives students these skills here, it doesn't matter how knowledgeable you are, because these robots that these cats are creating here are more knowledgeable than these kids will ever be. The human element of learning, the human element of the 21st century skills, that's what is magic about teaching and learning. And how do we honor that? How do we build that? And that's where UDL tells us this is a framework to give students choices, because when students have choices, it forces them to self-reflect and self-direct and to think and to learn from their mistakes, and to question what's best for me. And that's just the choice part. So how do we know which choices to give? We need to maximize their voices. So take a minute and just reflect on this part here and talk about why is choice so important. I want you to answer that question with someone next to you. Why is choice so important? And then we're gonna talk about, for a couple of slides, how do you maximize that with their voice? So chat. Okay. So just a couple more slides. Again, UDL is about giving students choice and optimizing voice, and we hear those terms a lot. Okay, choice is not options, choice is actually choice. And when you can empower students to make their own choices, you are not so worried about making sure that students have everything they need, because they will bring what they need to the table. And again, they can't do that yet, because that's another skill that has to be valued and taught. And there'll be a lot of times where they will not bring it, and that is why our voices are important. To say, you are struggling, let's talk about what you need. I need you to make that decision. And you will get pushback, naturally, because that is hard to do. It is hard to be successful. It is hard to be creative. So, interestingly, this is from Stone and Heen's book, Thanks for the Feedback, is they talk about that all of us have a unique swing recovery combination when it comes to feedback. When someone tells us something awesome, like, you are the best teacher I've ever seen, how long will that, like, keep you happy? And then when someone says, we all get those student evaluation things at the end of the semester, like, worst professor I've ever had, how long does it take you to recover from that? Okay? And that puts you in a box of how you feel about feedback. And what they find through their research is that most people are here, okay? They either absolutely hate it because the negative hurts too much and the positive is like, meh. So it's like you don't even want to open the evaluations, okay? If you're an elementary school teacher, a high school teacher, and a parent writes something horrible to you, you know, we all get those sometimes. Like, if it kills you to open up that email, you're here. Okay, some of us say we like feedback, but it's only the good kind. So you're like, I love evaluations, and then you're like looking for the good stuff, and then you're like, What bad? Oh, I know who that was. Okay? But we're actually not really open to the feedback. Some of us are like, whatever, I don't care. And then this right here. Now, what you'll notice is it doesn't mean that there's no sting for negative feedback. Nobody loves negative feedback. No one loves when a kid says, your lectures are horrifying to me. They are boring, I get nothing out of them. Hey, no one's gonna be like, that's great. But you get to a point where you're like, okay, I'm gonna self-reflect. That's not good. And then I'm going to self-direct. I need to do something different, okay? What you'll find is, okay, what do you think could be different? Well, I mean, you could like stop every 5 minutes and let us talk. Problem solved, in a small way. So it's not that you love the feedback. You love the fact that every bit of negative feedback can help you improve. And I'm gonna give you a great example of this. This is the best, the highest rated mountain lodge on TripAdvisor. And the only reason I know is because I Googled highest rated mountain lodge. And this came up. And then I feel a little like I have powers because I just made this slide a couple months ago and then it burnt down. Yeah, like do you think I'm responsible for that? So it's like I'm really sad about it because I went back recently to try to find reviews and I'm like, oh my word, like it's horrifying. But anyway, it used to be the best lodge on TripAdvisor. Now what you see here is an evaluation. There's three types of feedback: praise, mastery-oriented feedback, and evaluation. Okay, praise, purpose, increases motivation. Actually doesn't help you improve. So fascinating. We love it. It does not help you improve. I say you're awesome at this. You keep doing it. You don't do it better. Now, so we see a lot of people who are giving praise. Okay, fabulous. Evaluation, purpose, helps with self-assessment. Okay. Average place gets, let's say 80% positive reviews. I have 95% positive reviews. I know, when I reflect, I see that I'm better than the average. So that is helpful because I know where I stand. Doesn't help me improve. The only type of feedback that helps you to improve is mastery-oriented feedback, which means what could you do differently? We need to allow students to tell us what we could do differently. An evaluator comes in like a half hour at best every year. Okay, you can't wait for that. You have kids in front of you all the time. So let me show you how positive praise feels really good but is totally useless for our own improvement. Okay, this is a 5-star review. I'm just gonna read some keywords. Again, don't worry that you can't read it because it says, the lodge is gorgeous. Everything was perfect. We could see wildlife and even bears. It was crazy, worth the rate. Hey, lodge owner, is that going to help you make your lodge even better? No, it's useless, but it makes you feel good. Now, these right here are both 3 stars. Even though they're negative, I want you to think about how helpful that is. When you say to your students, I want you to tell me every 2 weeks what I could do better, what choices you wish you had, how could I help you improve? Okay, some of you are going, oh my gosh, no. Hate feedback, hopeful but fearful. Okay, and we can teach them to give it a little more respectfully. But it's helpful even when it's not respectful. So these are 2 3-star reviews, 1 respectful, 1 not so respectful. This one says, the lodge was very nice. We were disappointed with 3 things. Okay, the first thing was the room that we got was in the basement and it was moldy. The second was that I didn't have a view of the mountains because the trees were in the way. And the third was the breakfast didn't have any hot items. And then it says, ultimately it was close to town and very comfortable, but we'd try somewhere else next time. Okay? Can that help you improve? Yes. Like, that's magic. Okay, I need to worry about the filtration in that basement. I need to either make it really clear that there's no view or like bring the price of the room down. I had to throw in a waffle bar, but there's something I can do. And we wait till the end of the semester or the end of the year to ask for feedback and those kids are gone and our opportunity is like toast. But when we say, what choices do you need? Then you find out where you need to start. Okay, now this one, not so respectful, but also helpful. I asked them for a glass of wine. They gave it in a glass without a stem. The server had an attitude. I'm not sure of his name, but he had an attitude. Okay, that's good. But is there something there that we could do with our employees or our STEMware to make sure that doesn't happen again? Yes. So choice and voice are the magic of UDL. And when you're thinking about getting feedback from our students, we love to get praise and we love to give praise. And we get evaluation and we love to get evaluation. But how often do we do this? It is the only type of feedback that improves performance, and it is the least frequent type we give, because we're so busy up here teaching that we can't get around and give feedback. The teaching doesn't improve performance. It's not going to push kids a little further. But when we get out of our own way and say, listen, I'm going to do a mini lesson for 45 minutes, and then the next class, you can either go in the back and watch a video, you can come and sit with me, I'll continue to lecture, you can go read a book, you can go to the library. Like, you tell me how you need to learn it. Now I can sit down with kids and say, oh, no, this is where you're really struggling. This is where you need help. It's like the office hours in your room. So UDL is so effective. I just want to show you this data, and then I'm done. And this is my district, which is a pre-K to 12 district right outside of Boston, Massachusetts. And this is our data for our subgroup of students with disabilities. And the reason I'm showing you this is because nationally, we're worried about our subgroups more than all students. We're worried about our low-income students, our English language learners, our students with disabilities, go on, so on and so forth. And we are really, really struggling. In 2013, before we introduced UDL as a district, we scored a 29. Don't worry too much about that number. It's very bad. The state of Massachusetts overall is a 53 for students with disabilities. In 3 years, the state of Massachusetts went from a 53 to a 51. They actually lost ground with our students with disabilities. Whereas our district, through a really significant focus of UDL professional development, okay, we're up to 78 and a half hours a year. We get every other Friday off. Every other Friday is a half day to do PD on UDL. We went from a 29 to a 79 in 3 years. The state went down two. We went up 50. Okay, no, with over 400 districts in the state, no one touched us. And what is so fascinating about this is making it harder for kids with disabilities, okay, saying, no, I know you can figure this out. You tell me what you can do. Just tell me what you can do about this. Like, I believe in you. Like, get gritty, get creative. What happened was we actually got extra credit in all three subject areas, ELA, math, and science, because year after year, boom, boom, year after year, 3 years in a row, we had more than 10% than the year before of our students with disabilities who scored advanced on our state standardized test. A lot of the times we're just hoping for a pass, right? Just get a pass. Every year over year, 3 years in a row, in math, our students went over 10% the year before advanced. All kids are capable of expert learning. All students. That's right. Amen, sister. Okay. That was a really sad, sad applause. It's like, And so these are my babies. I'm ending with my babies. Okay. We did a Spartan race, and a Spartan race, as you know, it's like you run through mud, you go over an obstacle, you run through mud, you go over the obstacle. My husband and I do the Spartan Beast, which is like a 15 to 18 mile one. And so we're like, if we're doing one, you're doing one, kids. And you're supposed to sign up kids under 8 for the half a mile race, so of course we sign the waiver, and we're like, they're doing the 2 mile. And hey, kids can do anything, right? So we said to them, we're like, you know, you should probably do the 2 mile. And so this little one, the boys are like, I don't know. And my daughter's like, yeah, I'll do it. So then they're like, yeah, we'll do it. We'll do it with her. They did the 2 mile. My daughter asked, am I allowed to do like the really long one with you? We're like, oh no, that's not safe. But what ended up happening is this whole concept of kids can do amazing things when we give them the opportunity to try. We said, it was actually, they were like, you know, can we do the long one? We're like, yeah, sure, you can try. Okay, was it slow? Yes. Were they walking a lot of it? Yeah. But they were so proud, and this was their mean face. I'm like, you gotta look tough, boys. And Bowden ruined it. He wasn't looking tough. But so why is UDL necessary? Because I truly, honest to goodness, believe that all kids can be successful if we teach them how to find success in their own way. Okay? What is UDL? It's a framework No one's going to tell you exactly what you need to do. It's a framework. It's a way to view teaching and learning to give kids more choice and voice. And I can't tell you what that looks like for you, because you have to be an expert learner yourself. You have to be self-reflected and self-directed and say, how can I give students more choice? And I'm telling you, the first step is ask them. And then how are you going to do that? That's up to you. So thank you so much for spending a little bit of time with me. And if you want to learn more about the UDL movement, there's a million amazing resources online. And I am telling you, the more you learn about it, the more addicting it becomes. And just keep spreading the UDL love. So thank you so much for having me.
Stay up here. So what did you guys think? It's terrible, right? Awful. Blah! We are really, really fortunate to have her here, and again, please do check out, make sure, if you do tweet, and I know there are a few of you who've been tweeting here tonight, make sure that you tag at CTL at CSUN, and it's spelled out A-T, so CTLATCSUN, and then Katie's is Katie Novac UDL. So make sure we all connect and we educate Ed on Edge Novac. Katie is going to be going back there, and what's going to happen is while I do this raffle, Katie will walk back there. Don't attack her on the way. Please let her get all the way back there so she can sit down. And then anyone who wants to meet her, if you brought already a copy of your book and you'd like her to sign it, she could do that. Or the bookstore is always here and gracious. We really appreciate that the CSUN bookstore always brings books for us. You can get her book and she would be happy to sign it. And then her Twitter, you can always tweet to her if you have questions. She's really great at that. So let's give her another round of applause, please.